Dennis Compton, the golden boy of England cricket, died in a London hospital aged 78 on April 23, 1997. Dennis Compton will be remembered above all for the bringing glamour and infectious gaiety into a period of course. One of the greatest batsmen of any age, with a record over a 20-year career that will stand up to the severest examination. Yet it was the way Compton played the game that transcended any statistical niceties. For a few short years after the Second World War, Dennis Compton was the supreme entertainer. He was just 21 when war came, slowing his inevitable progress towards cricketing greatness. 6 years later, Compton and the rest of the cricket world started to inch towards some form of normality. For the next 5 years, the standard of English cricket was poor. A generation had been lost. Fast bowlers were scarce and the best players remained of pre-war vintage. One of the greatest artists and characters the game has known, Dennis Compton was a warm-hearted, carefree, sometimes careless genius. He was a dazzling right-handed batsman, a natural fielder with swift reaction, and occasionally a destructive bowler of left-arm unorthodox spin. He was a poor choice for the England, injuries permitting from 1938 until 1956. His batting had a poetic qualities mixed with the spirit of the eternal schoolboy. His most publicized stroke was the sweep, which he played extremely late. His most pleasing the cover drive plays exclusively out of the reach of the fielders, and like all perfect timers of the ball, his leg glance seemed not so much a stroke as a caress. He was a good hooker and cutter and was never tied to the crease. He loved to do battle, especially with the best wrist spin bowlers. But for all his occasional unorthodoxy, he had a sound basic technique. The only uncertainty about his batting lay in his running between the wickets, and while he was in the air, tended to be filled with call and counter calls. As Trevor Bailey said, a call from Dennis was merely the basic for negotiation. Punctuality for the start of play was never his strong suit, and he was once surprised to hear from another motorist on Vauxhall Bridge that the last day play in a test match at the Oval starting half an hour earlier than usual, which was already in progress. But his skill, good looks, charms, and natural generosity brought him a fan club of unrivaled proportions. He became the original Braille Kim boy, feature of a 1,000 advertisement. The agent who organized him, Baginall Harvey, founded a successful business around him, so much so that the many subsequent sports stars have called upon agents to look after their business affairs. Dennis Compton first turned out for Middlesex against Sussex at Lord's in 1936 as a slow bowler batting at number 11. Soon he was moving up the order and he made over 1,000 runs in his first season. He was to make at least 1,000 runs a season 17 times. Three times overseas. On his test debut against New Zealand at the Oval in 1937, he hit 65 in his next test against Australia at Trent Bridge. The following year, he hit his first century for England, 102. He could not tour South Africa in 1938-39 owing to his football contract with Arsenal. After the war, he scored 753 runs at an average of 94.12 against the South African in 5 tests. And in all first-class matches, he made 3,816 runs at an healthy average of 90.85, including 18 centuries, both of which constitute a record for a first-class season. He also took 73 wickets at an average of 28.12. Against Australia, the major power in those years, Dennis Compton was often England's mainstay, with 450 runs average 51 in 1946-47 and 562 runs average 62.44 in 1948. At Old Trafford, he edged the ball from Ray Lindwall into his own face and had to retire before returning, still bleeding, to hit 145 not out. About this time, an old football injury to his kneecap flared up and the Compton knee becomes a serious news topic. Some of his mobility was impaired, though not before he had slammed 300 in 3 hours for MCC against North East Transvaal at Banoni in South Africa 1948-49. The fastest triple century known, but some of the old dash left his play and he had a disaster test series in Australia in 1950-51, making only 53 runs in 8 test innings. He fought back and with Bill Eldridge at the Oval in 1953, made the winning hit which enabled England to win back the Ashes after 20 years. In his last test against Australia at the towel in 1956 after an operation to remove his right kneecap. Compton top scored with 94 and hit 35 not out in the second inning. His highest score in a test was 278 against Pakistan at Trent Bridge in 1954, and his best bowling 5 for 70 against South Africa in 1948-49. He captained Middlesex jointly in 1951 and 52 with Edridge. His benefit realized £12,200 in 1949. He was awarded the CBE and was a PR consultant, occasionally BBC commentator and cricket correspondent of the Sunday Express. With Arsenal FC, he won a league medal and cup winners a medal and earned 14 wartime England score caps. His elder brother Leslie, who played cricket for Middlesex and scored for Arsenal and England. Handsome, debonair and a dazzling improviser at the crease, Compton provided both excitement and glamour to sporting public desperate for entertainment after the grim war years. In common with his close friend Bill Edridge and the great Australian all-rounder Keith Miller, Compton lived life to the full. He was known to turn up for a test match in full evening dress. His timekeeping was notoriously bad and his attention sometimes wandered in the field. Dennis Compton born in the North London suburb of Hendon on May 23, 1980. Compton made his England debut at the age of 19 and in 1938 became the youngest man to score a century for his country with 102 against Australia at Trent Bridge. After serving briefly in India during the war, Compton returned to cricket and film star status in a British desperate for heroes. Dennis Compton's death came on the eye of 1997 English season, and his old side Middlesex observed a minute's silence before their match against Cambridge University at Barnes. Dennis was a great companion and a great man to have on tour, Bailey said. He was an orthodox player, but he was capable of great improvisation. He was lucky in every part of his sporting life. In 1947, it was roses all the way for him, and I shall always think of him as a golden cricketer.